you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message. Let's join Mike now.
My life, I've been an itinerant person most of my ministry, and this year will be my 42nd year in full-time ministry. And I started out barefoot, you know, preaching with holes in the knees of my jeans and hair down to my, really long hair. And anyway, so, you know, a lot of water has gone under the bridge. And a lot of people have come and gone. And I used to think that there'd be a day when there would be a cessation of the coming and going, and that things would settle down and solidify. And you know what? That is never going to happen. It really is meant to happen. It's just part of what you do when God chooses you to live this sort of life. And so I have never, ever, we have a thing in the States called Pastor's Appreciation Week or Month. And during that time, most churches in the States will give a gift of appreciation. This is not the pastor's salary. This is not his, you know, his package of, you know, support and stuff. This is just something they put together. Sometimes it's a monetary gift. Sometimes it's a vacation. Sometimes I have a friend who got Harley Davidson one time for his pastor's appreciation. he's got 4,000 people in his church too, and one of them's a Harley dealer. So let's not get too choked up, okay? So you know, that happens in my lifetime, in my life, and in my ministry time. That has never happened to me because I have never been a pastor. See, I've been an itinerant, so there's no Evangelist Appreciation Day. There's no Itinerant Appreciation Day. Now, that isn't that I haven't given. I got given a Harley Davidson, too. And it was for 35 years of working with the same group of guys and the same bikers and loving them no matter what. And, you know, one time I was preaching for them, and they just out of the blue gave me a Harley Davidson. 2 years later, the Lord had me sell it. So I'm not really sure what that was all about, but hey, you know, I asked my buddies, I said, well, now that I don't have my bike anymore, can I still be a Harley guy? And they said, oh, well, that's like being a Marine. Once a Harley guy, always a Harley guy. I said, well, I don't have my Harley now. They say, well, when somebody says, what kind of bike you have, don't say I don't have a Harley anymore. Say, I'm between motorcycles. So there you go. Hallelujah, you know. But one time I was preaching in a place in Georgia, St. Simon's Island. Actually, it was a little island off St. Simon's Island called Blythe Island, at Blythe Island Southern Baptist Church. The difference between a Northern Baptist and a Southern Baptist in the United States is a Northern Baptist will say, there ain't no hell. And a Southern Baptist will say, the hell there ain't. Anyway, so there you go. Anyway, now listen, for those of you that are going to see this online, just understand, this is me, okay? Don't complain to him about what I do. He has no control over what I do whatsoever. Don't even write Susan, okay? She tries the best that she can to keep me in line, but I don't recognize lines. I don't see lines. I don't believe in lines. The ditch is just as good to me as the middle of the road, you know? So if you got a problem, just send your complaint to me, and I'll just file it with everyone else, okay? Not a problem, okay? So anyway, I was preaching at this place, and I came in this Sunday morning, and I sat down, and there was a gift bag under my seat. And I reached under there, and I pulled out the gift bag, and it said, Pastor's Appreciation. Thank you, Pastor Mike. And I went to the pastor, and I said, I don't know about this. I said, I'm not you guys' pastor, Well, I've been preaching for a week there. And he said, well, this week you are our pastor. And this is Pastor's Appreciation Week. So here is a pastor's appreciation gift for you. And I got it. And I tell you, it meant so much. And it's like, you know, it's not like I hadn't been given other gifts. It's not that, you know, I mean, I've got this bracelet. And when I found out it was his birthday yesterday, I thought, you know what I'll do? I'll just give him this bracelet. And then I remembered he gave it to me, so. You know, I think it's okay to re-gift, but not to the dude that gave it to you, you know? I think there are some fruitcakes in the United States that have been around and re-gifted for like 120 years, but nobody notices. Anyway, So it's not like that, but it was about that certain thing that says, we appreciate you for leading us. We appreciate you for teaching us. We appreciate you for the words that you give, because you have no idea how many times we give all that we've got and we walk away from that experience thinking, did anybody get that? Did it make any difference to anybody? You know? And when you've been at it as long as I have, there are days when I sit at my desk thinking, I wonder if my life has meant anything. And then I'll get that email, you know. 15 years ago, you said something that changed my life. 25 years ago, you said something that changed my life. 40 years ago, I was in the occult, and I heard you speak. And today, I'm senior pastor of a church and have grandchildren of my own. And then that little gift says to you, thank you for doing the job you do. I mean, I appreciate people loving me, and I appreciate people being appreciative of me because I'm Mike, you know, because I'm Papa, because I'm Big Daddy for a lot of people, you know, and people give me things because they just like me. But when somebody gives you a gift because they appreciate what you do, and I mean above and beyond, you know, thank you for the salary, thank you for the insurance, thank you for the housing allowance, all the stuff you give us because we do the job we do. We appreciate that. But that little something extra, you know, that little something extra that just says, we appreciate you, we appreciate what you do, it means a lot. Anyway, this was my gift. It's not an Apple. It is it's a Galaxy. It's an Android platform. I don't do Apple. I will never do Apple. Apple is not of the Lord. It is a godless, demonic kind of thing. Because, well, I've read the book of Exodus, and it was an apple that got us into this. I should say Genesis. You know what I'm saying? So, of course, we don't know if it was an apple or not. For those of you that are dotting your I's and crossing your T's right now, I realize it just says a fruit, so I get it. In my opinion, it was probably an avocado, but you know, but for the sake of the joke and the never mind. You know, Sean, if we have to explain them, they're not funny. You know what I'm saying? It's not that they're not funny. It's just, you know what I'm saying. Anyway, that is not what I was going to say. I spent the early part of my life being told that I would never amount to anything. My parents died when I was pretty young. My dad died when I was 8. No, my mother died when I was 8. My dad died when I was 11. And both of them were vicious, horrible sort of alcoholics when they were drinking. They're great people when they were sober. They just weren't sober that much. My mother had been married 4 times. My father had been married 8 times. My dad was a lapsed Christian Scientist. I don't know how you do that. Because Christian Scientists is all about what you think, so I don't know how you can be unfaithful to what you think. But anyway, there you have it. My dad was talented, you know, and my mother was a lapsed Methodist. And so I had no real Christian upbringing, except there was a lady that used to come by our house and pick me up once in a while and take me to Sunday school. I remember she took me one time at Easter time, and that's when they used to make these little press cardboard little animals. You remember them? They just made out of kind of, yeah, it's like they made a slurry out of cardboard, shoved it in a mold, and you came out with like a bunny, and you know, and you had a little basket down here with some some of that grass in it and a couple of eggs. I thought that's who God was. I had it on my desk for a long time going, hey, old bunny. But anyway, so when my parents passed away and I went to live with people who were marginally related to me, one of the things that people would say to me is they'd always say, you're going to wind up just like your dad. You know, my dad was, he died an alcoholic, he died of alcohol poisoning, he died at 55. My mother was 36 years old when she passed away, drunk in a car accident. You know, a brutal mess of a death. And so it was always, you're never going to amount to anything, you're never going to be anything, you're never going to do anything. And so I grew up with a real sense of not being as good as everybody else. And I became a comedian, actually, when I was in high school. And Susan and I, by the way, now Susan and I, we have known each other since she was 13 and I was 14. When we graduated from high school, she went in one direction to become a successful banker in Beverly Hills, and I went in the other direction to become a a successful drug addict and seller at the beach. Anyway, so I'm not saying that they're the same, but at least we were both successful. Anyway, so Susan knows that when we were in school, I wasn't the class clown particularly, but I was a guy that always had a joke. I always had the gift of gab. I was always able to talk myself into things and talk my way out of things, and that was the mechanism that I used to cover the fact that in my heart, I felt like I would never, ever amount to anything because that's what everybody told me. And so as I began to go forward in my life, as I began to achieve, you know, I wasted my first shot at education because of drugs and alcohol. And then I went into the military because you could do that easily in the United States in the 60s because we had that little thing going on in Vietnam. When I went to Vietnam, I was successful at what I did. I earned my medals. I did my thing. I served my country. You know, I came home as a Marine, you know, and that's about as successful as you can get in our military. And then I had learned how to do medicine and emergency medical procedures and stuff while I was in Vietnam because that was my job. And so when I came home, I went to a school, and I did well in the school. And every time I did something well, I tried to go to people that were part of my family, part of my life, and stand before them and wait for the accolade. Well, you did well. But I had the kind of family that if you won a Cadillac and you said, hey, I want a Cadillac, they said, so what? The insurance will put us in the poorhouse. You know what I'm saying? Those kind of people. And I didn't get sympathy either, you know? I come home beat up to a shred, you know, some kid had jumped all over me, bullied me, punched me in the face. I'd come home with my nose bleeding, my eye black, and I'd go, Mom, and instead of going, oh, honey, she'd go, well, at least they didn't steal your coat. And it's like, really? You know, it's just, so I would go and I'd wait for the accolades, and the accolades never came. And so when I got saved, you know, I just wanted to go ahead and just, you know, preach the gospel to a bunch of hippies. I just wanted to go out, tell all those hippie guys that I knew that I found somebody that loved me no matter what. And I wanted to go out and tell them that there was somebody that loved them no matter what. And that if we all gave him a chance, he'd probably lead us in a direction where we could get away from some of the stuff that was killing so much of us. You know, for me, getting saved is a very practical thing. It was either death or get saved. You know, that's it, you know. But that's scriptural. You know, the Lord says, today I sit before you, life and death, blessing and cursing. So choose, you know. So anyway, and then all of a sudden, people began to really come to listen to what I had to say. And again, I waited for my peers to say, really good job. And that never happened. And so then I wrote a book, and the book became a bestseller. And the world recognized that. But what I got from my peers was criticism, you know. And then I began to preach, and lots of people began to come. And, you know, I got built up in everybody's eyes, but nobody really knew me, you know. I mean, I was somebody that stood in the spotlight, and as long as I was in the spotlight, I existed. But the minute I stepped out of the spotlight, I didn't exist for anybody anymore. And everybody that knew me outside the spotlight didn't have anything, they didn't have anything uplifting or upgrading to say to me whatsoever. As a result, you know, I went through 3 marriages before I got to Susan. And she and I have been married for, 23 years now, because she's a person that she doesn't chicken out easily. Being always trying to live up to somebody's expectations and stuff, you know, in a relationship, that makes you so needy that it almost drives people away. And, you know, I can stand here and say and give excuses for the fact that I've been through 3 broken marriages. And the tendency is to do that, because in the body of Christ, you're not supposed to get divorced at all. You know, that's not a good thing to have happen to you. And so when it does happen, you want to justify yourself by vilifying the others. But, you know, I, first of all, I'm a gentleman, so you don't do that. Amen. And then if you're a Christian, how do you really rake somebody over the coals and then blame that on the Holy Ghost? I don't see how that works at all. So I can't do that. So all I can say to you, the problem that I understand was the problem that I had. And the problem I had was I was so needy, I put so many expectations on people. And because the only place I was getting any accolades was in the spotlight, I did 25 days a month on the road. 25 out of 30 days every year, every month, all year long for 20 years. Well, you marry somebody and you leave them, you know, to fend for themselves. If you don't think you're going to come home and find somebody else's slippers under the bed, you're out of your mind, you know? It was a lot of years that I just, you know, I was doing what I did because it was my way of proving to all those people back in the day that I was somebody. You know, I got my platinum album. I got my gold album. You know, I was making good money and living in a big house, and I had 2 or 3 Cadillacs, you know. And from the outside looking in, everybody thought that my life was successful. But during the height of my career, I spent 2.5 years absolutely suicidal. And this is back before 9/11, so you could carry firearms in your suitcase in those days, as long as you told them, you know, hey, I got an unloaded gun in my bag. Okay. You know, I mean, that's the United States, you know. So anyway, I carried a 9mm Beretta in my suitcase, and I carried a clip, you know, full of ammunition. And every morning I got up and I sat down at the desk in whatever hotel I was in. And I would take a piece of paper and I'd draw a line down the middle. And then I would draw a short line across the top, maybe about down that far. And over here in that space, I would write reasons to live. And then over here, I'd write reasons to die. And I would sit, Jim, and I would write down all my reasons to live. And then I would write down all my reasons to die. And my gig was, the day that it got one more reason to die than to live, I would go into the bathroom in whatever hotel I happened to be in, and I would get in the tub, and I would shoot myself. That way, none of my family, my kids, or anything would have to find my body. And I would be on porcelain, so it would be easy for the maids to clean up. Now, that's a real gentleman, you know what I'm saying? You know, don't want to make a mess, you know, so. But I did that. I did that for 2.5 years. And then one morning, I had this revelation. And the revelation was, God was giving me a miracle that I didn't recognize every morning of my life for 2.5 years. Because I was expecting other miracles. I was expecting God to do the things I was asking him to do. God, make my life better. God, make people appreciate me. God, make people love me. God, make people care about me. Make people love me for who I am, not just because I'm in a spotlight, because I'm just a phantom in there. Nobody, I'm not real in that spotlight. You know, nobody's real in the spotlight because it casts shadows on you that don't really exist in real life. Nobody is this bright all the time. You know what I'm saying? So those were my prayers, you know. Why can't I find somebody that I can be married to that won't leave me after a while? Why am I not able to keep my kids? Why am I a bad father? Why am I never going to amount to anything? Why am I such a failure? Why, you know? In the meantime, you know, I've got 10, 11, 12,000 people in a night coming to Anaheim Convention Center, having to turn 4,000 or 5,000 people away because they can't get in, screaming bloody murder for me and my name and laughing and you know, got all the stuff. But the minute I step back out of the light, I don't exist for anybody anymore, not even for myself. And I'm saying, God, this has got to change. This, I can't go on like this. I'm going to shoot myself, Lord. I can't be this alone all the time. I'll tell you what it was like. Life was like being in a river up to your neck and not being able to get wet. And I wanted to die. I was as popular as I've ever been. I had more money than I've ever had. You know, if I didn't pay $600 for a pair of shoes, they weren't a pair of shoes. You know, Susan used to laugh at me. I had more jewelry than any woman you can think of, you know. I had one tray this big, just rings. And it was divided, diamonds over here and other stuff over there, you know. You know, I was bad Leroy Brown. Love to wear his diamond ring up and everybody knows because he's bad Leroy Brown. Anyway, so, sorry, Jim Croce moment. I'm all right now. Anyway, and the laughter, you know, everybody said, man, he must be really happy. I wasn't happy. Laughter was the mask I wore because I didn't want anybody to see who I really was. So I knew who I really was because everybody already told me who I really was. I wasn't worthy. I wasn't going to amount to anything. I wasn't lovable. I was a screw up. I couldn't keep a decent relationship, you know. And then it happened one morning. All of a sudden, I realized the miracle. God was making my list of reasons to live one thing longer than my reasons to die. Every morning for 2.5 years. In other words, God saw something in me. God saw something in me, and because God saw something in me, He was keeping me alive because He had things that He thought I could do that couldn't be done by anybody else. Because if they could have been done by somebody else, He would have let me go ahead and die, and He would have just taken His spare and put that spare in my place. But He didn't want that. And all of a sudden, I guess it was that morning, I realized, if I'm not anybody to anybody else, I'm somebody to God. And even if nobody sees me when I step out of the spotlight, He does. And even if nobody likes what they see, He likes what He sees. Enough to keep me around, to keep doing the things that He has me doing, because in His economy, I'm the only one that He has called that can do these precise things, because I'm the only one He ever created to be me. And you know what? It changed everything. Because I'm happy. Clap along and give you. In the middle of all of that destruction, God said to me, listen, I'm just clearing the table. Now we're going to do things my way instead of the record company's way and the TV company's way and the movie company's way and all of the bean counters' way and all the people that were making money off of you. We're going to do it my way now. So they didn't love you except for what you could give them. I love you and you don't have nothing now. I just want you to know that I didn't have anything, Paul. It wasn't that I had gotten down to ground zero. I was ground zero minus 60,000 feet. I mean, I was in a hole, baby, you know, with no way out, no way whatsoever. And God said, in this place is where I love you. Now, I'm standing in the supermarket. I've got a coupon for baked beans and a coupon for toilet paper, but I only have enough money for one or the other. The answer is buy the beans and have them put it in paper bags. And if you're lucky enough for God to give you somebody that embodies the love that He has for you and you can see it and touch it, then bless the Lord, you know? And I've been lucky to have that. But I was nearly 50 years old before I found it. And you have a destiny and a purpose, and even if nobody else sees it or knows about it, God knows. On the coldest nights, in the deepest sky, God knows.
We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.